The 1991 Sugar Bowl clash between the Tennessee Volunteers and the Virginia Cavaliers. Brought to you in part by the Center for Addiction Recovery at Fort Sanders Park West Medical Center. By Hardee's, we're out to win you over. By TIS, Tennessee Insurance Services, committed to service since 1945. By your Lincoln Mercury dealers, who invite you to come in and test drive the new Tracer. And by your East Tennessee Natural Gas Distributors. Natural gas means lower utility bills and warm air comfort. And now to New Orleans and Big Orange on the Bayou.
Hello, East Tennessee and Southeast Kentucky. Welcome to Wet Wild, New Orleans, Louisiana. New Year's Eve celebration here tonight, but a big game coming up tomorrow. The Tennessee Volunteers and the Virginia Cavaliers. Hello, everyone. I'm Jim Wogan, and Sam Brown is with us here tonight on a wet night in New Orleans, but it's certainly not putting too much a damper on the spirit around this place.
It certainly isn't. The temperature's gone down about 30 degrees. We've had fantastic weather the whole week down here, Jim. But this is the place to be. We're on the roof of Jack's Brewery, where at midnight, the gigantic ball is going to come down and usher in 1991. Down below us, in the French Quarter, in Jackson Square, along the Mississippi River, there will be tens of thousands of Big Orange fans, along with everybody else in the Easy City, and celebrating the new year, and this is the place to be. We're going to have a lot of fun in the next hour.
Well, I'll tell you what, about 40 minutes ago, I didn't have many high hopes for what the celebration might turn out to be, but we talked to some people between then and now, and they said, whether or no weather, there'll be a lot of people down there for New Year's Eve, and as Sam said, we're about six floors up over the square itself, so we'll be very close to the action.
They'll all turn out. Everybody, all the natives in New Orleans say these people aren't afraid of rain, they aren't afraid of a little bad weather. They are not afraid of having a good time, and that's what we're going to have in the next hour.
And it's amazing how much they have here to keep them busy, because not only do they have the Sugar Bowl game coming up tomorrow, the New Year's Eve celebration tonight, the NFL game going down the street, they got the big ball coming up, coming down here in just a couple of minutes, much like Times Square in New York City. So it's one big, massive celebration, and if New Orleans ever has a reason to throw a party, these folks will do it, and they've got a lot of reasons to throw parties this week.
They've got a big game tonight. They're playing the Rams, and then they'll turn that Superdome around. Of course, the weather in the Superdome is going to be fantastic, 72 degrees. We were in there a few times this week. It is a magnificent facility, and I've been following the Big Orange fans all week, following them through the French Quarter, the Garden District, along the Mississippi River, just having a blast, and they're down here to have a good time and root the Vols on to victory. And let's take a look at some of the activity that we've seen throughout the week for those great, fantastic Tennessee Big Orange fans.
Vol fans know that New Orleans is a special city, and they'd come here to party and shop and eat, even if there weren't a Sugar Bowl championship at stake. The French cuisine alone would make any palate pleased. The Vols invaded in 86 against Miami, and the massive wave of Big Orange dominates Virginia supporters this year, too. That's what New Orleans natives I talked with were talking about, and they weren't just clowning around.
Where is the people from Virginia?
They're not here.
They're not here. Where they at?
Can you see any of them?
Virginia, very intelligent.
Sir, you have the distinction of being the only Virginia fan that I've seen in a long time. Where's Virginia?
Somewhere up east.
There are Vols down here in all shapes and sizes, from the conservative to the, well, bizarre, like Oak Ridge's Jeff Backus with his big orange beard.
Well, it just grows this way. When you bleed orange, you know, it grows this way. I started doing this last year for the Cotton Bowl, and I get a kick out of it, and the fans get a kick out of it, so I just do it for every game now.
You look like the ultimate Big Orange fan. I've seen a lot of Big Orange fans around here.
Well, I think I want to be one of them for sure. It's just, you know, I've had a really good time and looking forward to us winning.
I take it you think New Orleans is the perfect place for a bowl.
It's wonderful. Actually, it's my favorite city in the world, and I'm so pleased that the Vols gave me an opportunity to come here.
Even the Virginia fans, estimated to be outnumbered 5-1, were reluctant to show their colors on Bourbon Street. In 86, the Vols owned Bourbon Street. And with Vol fans shelling out millions of dollars this year, they certainly paid for it again.
I understand you're from Halls in Knoxville. What message did you want to give us?
I'd like to say that if it wasn't for Doug Dickey and Johnny Majors, that the city of New Orleans would go bankrupt if we didn't come down here every 5 years. It would flat not make it.
We keep the city up, I guess.
You got that right.
The Vols certainly took over places like Pat O'Brien's, where the party has lasted almost around the clock. It's a New Orleans tradition.
We go to Pat O'Brien's for a beer, and then we go to Pat O'Brien's for a beer. And then what do?
Then we go to Powder Bronze for a hurricane.
Eyewitness News wanted to investigate where the Big Orange go to have a good time on Bourbon Street. So?
Go Big Orange!
What does Harriman, Tennessee do when it parties down on Bourbon Street?
We join it. What else can you do? Just get with it.
And so, it's New Year's Eve. The party's gaining momentum, and we've still got the game. From a ball standpoint, New Orleans is the perfect place for a victory and a victory celebration.
Those Big Orange fans, some of the greatest in the world, and as you saw, one of the chief concerns, I don't know whether it's a concern or not, it's not a concern to a Big Orange fan, but it's perhaps a concern to the Virginia fans. They're just hard to find around here. They may be hiding in the hotels. They were afraid to come down to Bourbon Street and show their colors. I mean, the Big Orange came down here. The Vol fans have totally dominated the French Quarter and Bourbon Street, as they did in 1986, and the people in 86 tell me who were here that they are absolutely in as full strength numbers as they were then. Some 23,000 tickets have been sold. 5,000 had to be returned from Virginia.
We talked with a merchant when we got down here initially, and we asked him how things were going, and he said there are plenty of Tennessee fans down here, but they think there are only about 8,000, maybe 9,000 Virginia fans. I want to run down a little bit about what you'll see in the next hour, or maybe next 50 minutes now, I guess.
Yeah.
It remains in the show. We have a number of stories coming your way. We'll look back at the 1990 season as far as the Tennessee Volunteers are concerned. And we'll talk with one of the players from the 1985-86 Sugar Bowl team with us live right here, Scott Finley. We'll look back at that big game that a lot of Tennessee fans will never forget. Big game between Tennessee and Miami just a few years ago over there at the Superdome. And we have an interview with head coach Johnny Majors. A total hour of programming coming your way,
and
all about the Tennessee Volunteers.
An incredible 45 more minutes coming up, ladies and gentlemen. Stay tuned for more Big Orange on the Bayou. We'll be back right after these messages live from New Orleans. Stay with us. Hello again, live from New Orleans. I'm Sam Brown, along with sports director Jim Wogan. And, you know, the celebration's already started. We're just less than 5 hours away, but I can already hear the yells down on Jackson Square. We are the place to be, the French Quarter, Mississippi River right over there, the big ball coming down in just a few hours, and we are Big Orange on the Bayou.
Well, I'll tell you what, not only can you hear the folks, but you can smell the aroma of the food. If there's one thing about New Orleans, it's a very ethnic city. There's a lot of culture here, and they love their food in this city, and you can really get a good taste for what's going on down below, being six stories up here.
Yeah, they're having a big party about 50 feet away, and it's going to last on three floors. And the cook,
hot and spicy, I guess, you know, the Volunteers this past season. One way to describe them, you go all the way back to the beginning of the year when it was hot out there in Anaheim against the Colorado Buffaloes. A few weeks later in Starkville, Mississippi, it was a hot day that day when the Vols rolled up a big score against Mississippi State. You go right on through the season. One thing about the season, you look back in the Tennessee Volunteers, there were plenty of high points, and certainly the folks back home, the fans back home, and the fans down here have a lot to talk about, a lot to be proud about, but there were a few low points as well. And I guess with any football team, whether you win the national championship or not, you're going to run through low points during the season. But the Volunteers have been resilient all along, and they've given Tennessee Volunteer football fans a lot to be proud of this year. Now we'll take a look back at the 1990 season for the University of Tennessee.
The Vols opened the season 2,000 miles from home. The Pigskin Classic turned out to be just that, classic. Tennessee trailed fifth-ranked Colorado by 21 with 10 minutes to play. Andy Kelly had to throw a record 55 passes, but the Vols fought back for a tie that fans said felt like a win.
Well, actually, you know, we were kind of disappointed we tied them, you know, so we should have won that game.
Tennessee's home opener was supposed to be easy. Instead, it was devastating. Heisman candidate Chuck Webb goes down with a first quarter knee injury. The Vols demolish a team coached by former UT assistant Walt Harris, but Webb was lost for the season.
Well, it's certainly one of the dark moments in not only our season, but since I've been at Tennessee, was when Webb went down, Chuck Webb went down against Pacific.
With Webb out, the Vols open the conference schedule at Starkville. SEC action's always hot, but the pregame temperature was almost too tough to take.
During the game, I was thinking back to our freshman year, how hot it was then, and I was trying to think, was it this hot or is it hotter today? Was it? And, you know, that's the only really game that I really got fatigued in.
If anyone was tired, it had to be Tony Thompson. The senior running back filling in for Chuck Webb clicked for 248 yards, and the Vols win by 33. September 15th was almost an off week. UTEP was in town, but the hospitality was horrible. The Vols roll up 56. Enough of the soft stuff. Some said this was for the SEC championship. Wasn't supposed to be this easy. The Vols led 13-0 after this 82-yard weaving touchdown reception by Alvin Harper.
Oh, that was a big play, and it was a big boost for us. You know, that's the game you look back on, and another one of those that you look and say, if this or if that, a break here or a break there.
The breaks, though, seemed to go Auburn's way. The Vols this time had to settle for a tie, second one of the season. Explosive, the best way to sum up this one. Tennessee erupted for 28 third quarter points and wound up winning their fourth game of the season against Florida. By late October, with a week off, the Vols seemed to be set for Bama. But then again, strange things happen when the Vols play these guys. Philip Doyle's field goal with 4 seconds left stuck the Vols with a 9-6 loss.
I'm just able to play a lot better than we did that game, and it hurt.
Life goes on, and so do the Vols. Roland Poles pounded the Temple Owls for 3 touchdowns. Need we say more? The Irish came to Knoxville a week later and ranked number one in the country. 6 days of hype and hoopla, and the game lived up to it. The Vols were down by 11 late until Andy Kelly hit Alvin Harper on this 23-yarder. But the upset bid taken away by Irish defensive back Rod Smith. Still, about as good a game as you can get. The Vols, though, dropped a 5-2-2. This was supposed to be an away game, but the Rebs move it to Memphis, where Vol fans pack the Liberty Bowl. The Vols and Ole Miss battle for the SEC championship. Tennessee wins. The Sugar Bowl was in sight, but the Vols were cautious.
There were a pretty good sense that, you know, we had a great chance of going to the Sugar Bowl then.
2 games to go, and neither would be easy. The Cats hit Knoxville and drill the Vols early, led by 14 twice. Tennessee's second half, though, was just as impressive. Tennessee wins their 7th of the season. UT gets to close the season in Nashville. Vandy gave the Vols fits early, but Tony Thompson scored 4 touchdowns. 3 came in the second half. Tony racked up 236 yards, and the Vols came away winners and wrap up a Sugar Bowl bid in the process.
Won the Sugar Bowl, but we're not ranked number one, and that's something that we really wanted, you know, as a team.
Vols wind up with an 8-2-2 record and wind up in the Sugar Bowl once again. Not a bad season, and a guy who can relate to all this and a guy who probably needs no introduction to Tennessee football fans, Dale Jones, a member of the 85 and 86 Sugar Bowl team. Dale, I got to ask you first, you know, you've been through this thing before. Players are going to sack out here in about an hour or so and get ready for the hit the sack and be up tomorrow for the big game. What thoughts are going through their minds today, and how are they putting the final touches on preparations?
Well, right now they're probably having dinner, and after dinner they're going to meetings, and then after meetings, you know, they'll have time on their own. And this is when all the players usually get together and start getting their game face on. You know, it's when everybody wants to just do a lot of concentrating. And then, you know, really it starts tomorrow, because it's been such a long day. They don't want to get over obnoxious. And I think that at this time, though, I know they're getting ready, because around the hotel, you know, all the fans are there and it's rowdy. And I know it's got to make them feel good.
I know that one thing Coach has done is kind of let them run a loose ship a little bit here recently with all the celebrating that's been going on. They've been disciplined, but they've been having fun. How do they shift gears and go from that frame of mind into a, so to speak, game face state of mind?
Well, that's one thing that Coach Majors does a job that, you know, it's hard to have your game face on early in the week, and there's so much going on. But as it gets closer, you know, he does take the reins and starts tightening it up. And I think the players, you know, they do it on their own too. It's just a natural thing that, you know, that Coach Majors does a good job of letting you have fun. But as it gets closer, then you got to get, you know, it's time to get down to business.
How long is tomorrow going to be for these guys?
Well, it'll be a long time. It takes, you know, that day, especially in a big game like this, it just doesn't seem like it's going to happen. And then all of a sudden it's there. And I'm sure that's, you know, that's difficult for a lot of players. It really is.
You've been through this whole thing before, and you've had a chance to see the Vols play a little bit this year. The Florida game in particular, maybe you can let fans back home be a little bit more aware of your connection with Florida and your opportunities to see the Vols this past season.
Well, I got to coach against them, and then later in the year, which we didn't do very well, but Later in the year, I came back. We were off that week, so I came home and watched them play again. And I saw them two or three times on TV. They're an outstanding team. I think defensively, they're probably they got some of the best guys in the league. There's no doubt about it. And then offense, everybody knows how good they are on offense. But I think they got a big challenge ahead of them. I think, you know, the University of Virginia has one of the best offenses in the country. And with that quarterback coming back, it's going to be tough.
All right, Dale Jones, who is a volunteer assistant coach right now with the University of Florida and hoping to continue in collegiate football with his coaching future, and he knows what this whole situation is all about. We'll be back with more Big Orange on the Bayou, fly from New Orleans, Louisiana, in just a minute. Welcome back to New Orleans, Louisiana. Wet and wild, I guess, tonight on New Year's Eve as the entire city is celebrating the New Year's Eve holiday, celebrating an NFL game down the street, and getting set for a Sugar Bowl game tomorrow between Virginia and Tennessee. Hi, everyone. I'm Jim Wogan, and as we mentioned, the weather's been a little cool around here, but we'll get through this next 40 minutes or so with a look back at the Tennessee Volunteers season and a look ahead at tomorrow's game between the Vols and the Cavaliers. You know, Tennessee's been involved in this Sugar Bowl thing five different times. They're no stranger to the pressure of playing in this game. We'll look back now at the history of the Volunteers in the Sugar Bowl. The Vols have played in five Sugar Bowl games. The first was back in 1941 against Boston College. Tennessee led 7-0 after one half, but the Eagles come back to soar in this one by six. 2 years later, the Vols were right back at it. This time, they even their Sugar Bowl record at 1-1 with a 7-point win over Tulsa. In 1951, the Vols were led by a scrappy tailback named Hank Lorasella. Tennessee won 10 straight. The Vols were preseason national champs and kings of the conference, but were beaten by Maryland in the 1952 Sugar Bowl. It was the Generals' last bowl game as a Vol head coach. 1957, former Vol Bowden Wyatt's in charge, and Tennessee faces Baylor. Tailback Johnny Majors fumbles the ball and a punt return in the fourth quarter. Tennessee was leading 7-6. The Vols wind up losing 13-7. The 1960s came and went, but Tennessee never made a return trip to the Sugar Bowl until 1971. The Vols break a three-game bowl game losing streak. Tennessee scored 24 points in the fourth quarter. Bobby Scott was named game MVP. The Vols held Air Force to minus 12 yards rushing and wound up winning 34-13. You know, it's amazing how the game has gone through some changes over recent years. All those Sugar Bowl games Tennessee played in, the four right there, were played outdoors. We intentionally left one off that little story right there. That was the big game back in 86, Tennessee and Miami. Just a few minutes, Scott Finley will look at that game, a momentous occasion for Coach Johnny Majors, the Tennessee Volunteers, and Tennessee football fans. We'll be back live from New Orleans in just a minute.
To get a Super Bowl ring, I had to listen to this.
I'll never forget it when Tennessee was playing Miami, and I believe you got a preview, or Scott Finley has a preview of probably one of the most tremendous games the University of Tennessee has ever played.
Well, Johnny Majors has said that it's one of his biggest coaching victories ever,
right.
And for a guy who's won the national championship in a Sugar Bowl game,
that's big stuff.
That's saying something. Scott Finley now looks back at a big game for the Tennessee Volunteers back in 1986.
They don't have any respect for you. Make them remember you as long as they live. The way you hit, the way you knock them down fields, the way you hustle.
Remembering what the Vols did that New Year's Day, not hard if you're a Tennessee fan. The Big Orange's 35-7 romping of Miami brought Tennessee back to the national level. More than the game that's memorable, it's the atmosphere of what took place.
The massive turnout from our fans was just incredible, and it was an unreal charge to be there and to be on the field and to get ready to perform in such an atmosphere. That was the thing that sticks out in my mind.
The underdog stamp put on the Vols served to be the motivator. Miami's cockiness and concern more for the national title than Tennessee did them in.
One of Miami players said, I thought that all the Vols were over AEIO and you know. And a lot of people, I remember Marco Vanek, he really got ticked off about that.
Alonzo Highsmith is supposedly a great running back.
He told us, he goes, the only Vols he knows is A-E-I-O-N-U. Well, he knows Tennessee right now, baby, because we kicked their butt.
They talked a lot of trash, I guess, but, you know, they could back it up. They had proved it the whole year, so.
It goes to Jeff Howard.
The players in this game will remember it for what they came away with.
I've carried that on. It'll help me in my coaching career and what I'm going to do. And, you know, you keep after what you believe in, and you keep sticking it out and keep putting your nose in there. Good things will happen to you.
I have yet to meet someone that went to New Orleans and didn't say, man, it was the best time of my life. You know, it was the greatest game. It hits you in the heart, or it does me anyway, about what I've been a part of.
A Sugar Bowl of heart, a Sugar Bowl of fun, most of all, a Sugar Bowl of memories. Scott Finley, TV6 Live Sports.
Great one to look back on. If there's one difference, though, between that game and the game coming up tomorrow and the game a few years ago, Tennessee was the underdog, pulled off the upset over Miami. Tomorrow, they're the favorite in the game.
We'll take the win. We'll take a win anytime. I think Johnny Majors says that.
Yeah.
Right now, we're going to take a break. We'll be back with Big Orange on the Bayou live from New Orleans in a minute.
They'd rather be in two-a-days than playing us today. Now, they go to school.
You, Ma. You too, Teresa.
A few weeks after Mississippi State was whipped down in Starkville, the Florida Gators came to Knoxville with no conference losses. Steve Spurrier was in his first year with Florida, and the Gators were on a roll. But the Vols and Vol fans had no idea what would happen next. Russ Hollingsworth continues our Six in the Sideline flashback with a look at an impressive win over Florida.
When you look at these two teams tonight, Florida and Tennessee on paper, Gary, they are so close. I don't know how you pick a winner.
Well, there's no reason why it shouldn't be a close game.
The team that I inherited was number three in the nation in defense last year. Offensively, all we had to do was be able to score a few points. We don't have to score a lot with the way our defense plays.
You don't play games on paper or in the papers. According to the game maximums, kicking game, field position, turnovers, discipline, don't beat yourself. This is a town everyone is reaching for the top. This is a place for second best will never get. It's okay to want to shine, but once you step across that line, no matter where you hide, I'm coming after you. Shake down, break down, honey, just about the time to figure it's all right. Break down, take down, you're busted.
Tennessee has blown this one open. This is unbelievable. Steve Spurrier. And what must be going through his mind?
Break down, take down, down. You busted, busted. Shake down, break down, take down.
Tell you the truth, though, Ron, I think they could bring in John Elway with the type of pressure that Tennessee's putting on him right now. It's not going to have any effect on this game.
Break down, take down, you busted. Now, SEC, we're coming, baby. You got.
That was an awesome outburst in that game, and Tennessee Volunteer football players continue to talk about it. But Vol fans think that win gave Tennessee the reputation as the toughest team in the SEC. Technically, Florida wound up with a better record. But a few weeks later down in Memphis, the Vols and Ole Miss decided to settle the SEC battle for themselves.
Has to forget that it's playing a powerful Tennessee team and just play football.
Fourth turnover of the day for Ole Miss.
Stay ready. Let's get out in the game.
Mercury makes drive.
Hi, everyone. Welcome back to a wet New Orleans, Louisiana on New Year's Eve, where the Volunteers and Cavaliers are getting set for a football game. Now, for you folks back in Knoxville, I want to explain something rather quickly here. We have gone to a simultaneous broadcast with our sister station in Richmond, Virginia. We've already been introduced to the Richmond folks during that last break, but for you Tennessee folks, I want to introduce Chip Tarkenton, who is a sports director at WRIC-TV. Chip,
hello,
welcome.
Hello, Knoxville.
Chip's going to give us the Virginia perspective on everything tonight.
Yeah, we're going to take a look at Sean Moore, who everybody's talked about this year. We'll also take a look at Virginia's season. Got a lot of fun things coming up. This is going to be great fun. It's great to be with you.
We have had a lot of fun the whole week. I've got one question for you. Where are the Virginia fans, Chip?
Well, we went into hiding, waiting for the announcement on Sean being able to start at quarterback.
Right.
So now we can come out tonight.
Oh, okay. Well, I couldn't find any on Bourbon Street or couldn't find any around the French Quarter, so
we'll help you out tonight.
That's good. But it has been a whole lot of fun working together, and that's what a football game is all about, having fun.
Well, there'll be plenty of fans down here in just a little while, too. Football fans and New Year's Eve fans. A big celebration planned behind us down there in Jackson Square in the French Quarter, but let's see your area.
It was a great year, and, you know, everybody got excited about Virginia football, especially when they went 7-0, and I still think there's a lot of excitement. Despite losing three of the last four, a lot of people are injured, so this football team is a pretty good football team. Why don't we jump in now and take a look at the season review? Our Steve Bucci has that for you right now.
Talk about all those different things, and he began things by talking about that great 86 win over Miami.
It's one of those days where it was all Tennessee. Things went our way. We made a lot of things go our way. And it's an event and a time that I will never forget as long as I live. This year, it's another year, another team, another opponent. The shoe's on the other foot. We're favorites. Virginia's sitting in a very good situation. So it's up to us to play as favorites and try our best to win as favorites.
You talk about challenges going down to face Virginia. Do you get a sense that this may be a high-scoring football game with their offense and your offense?
Oh, it could play. Both teams could score 35 or 40 points, but I'm not saying that we are. I really don't know. I would be surprised if we don't have to score 30 points or more if we can to win the ball game because they're so explosive on defense, I mean on offense. The Moore guys, the Moores are very difficult. And the Moores don't necessarily mean better for us. I wouldn't be surprised if we're going to score quite a bit to win the ball game if we're capable of doing that. I don't think it will be a defensive shootout. But I've been surprised before.
Looking back at the season, obviously one of the low points was when Chuck went out with the injury. Do you have any sense at this point if he'll be back next year or what his future is at Tennessee?
I'm optimistic that he'll be back next season. And according to how his rehabilitation goes and getting himself in good condition and staying on track academically and doing the job there. He has informed us that he is coming back in the spring semester. And it'll be touch and go to see how he reports in the fall. Some people have had excellent recoveries from that standpoint, and we're enthusiastic that he can too.
Coach, season's gone real well with the SEC championship and the Sugar Bowl berth, but do you still have a sense for what might have been, given the fact that you didn't come up with the number one ranking?
Oh, sometimes, not greatly, because youth move on. They don't live in the past very long, and frankly speaking, none of us should. It's hard to not think about what could have happened. We could possibly be the number one team, but we are not. We're the number one team in our conference. We played the number one schedule probably in America. When you do that, it's very difficult to win them all.
There was a sense, I think, from the fans' point of view and possibly from the media that Virginia was a less than attractive opponent in the Sugar Bowl.
We try to do the best we can to control the things we can control. We can't control what the media and the fans think about how untough somebody might be, because they're not normally accustomed to playing or coaching the game. They earned what they got when they were number one. They lost a couple of tough ball games, and their quarterback got injured. And they got several other people who were hurt. When you lose the close games on occasion, and you have injuries, that changes your whole team. Now they've got most of their good people back, so we're going to see the real Virginia.
Johnny Majors is not taking Virginia lightly by any means. This entire broadcast now, the entire show we've done, rebroadcast tomorrow at 10 a.m. Sam, it's been fun.
All I can say is go Vols. So long, everybody. Have a happy New Year.
Happy New Year.